this in a very dignified fashion. Man, it's good to see you guys. Amen. Good to have everyone here this morning. Good to have our folks on the online service here. Glad to have them as well. And I'm expecting something great from God today. Every week I get up and I say, I'm excited. And I'm really excited today because this is such a beautiful day. Amen. It is Resurrection Sunday. It is Easter Sunday, whichever way you like to refer it to. Both correct. Amen. But we're going to have a great time for the Lord today. Because I've been asking God. I said, God, I want you to take over with the power of your Holy Spirit. Man, I don't have it. I just do not have it. But he does. Amen. And we've got to realize that. We're going to be going places. Amen. It's not about us. It's all about him. Amen. So good to see you. If you're a visitor, didn't get a visitor card, first time visitor, would you raise your hand? We want to make sure that you get one. Amen. Right there, Bill. Right there, we got one. We want to welcome you. Amen. It's first time here. Anybody else first time here? Didn't get a visitor card? All right. Well, we want to know who you are. Now we will not bug you. Okay. How many would like to be bugged by a preacher when you go visit church? Two people.
Oh,
we won't bug you. We'll send you a letter.
Do that. Who you are. Amen. So we are glad to have each and every one of you this morning. There will be no service tonight on Easter. On the holidays, we take the evening off. So, because you may have a big Easter family reunion lined up, and you want to be able to have time to do that. So you enjoy your family tonight. Also, I'll mention this. Tonight over at the, what's Brother Robertson's church's name? Anyway, Abundant Life. If you go like you're going to Sedalia, and right before you get to 65 Highway, take a left on a road there. Can't think of what it's called. Brother Robertson is having Jeff and Sherry Easter over there tonight. Amen. It is a charge, though. I think it's $20. $20, 6 o'clock. Amen. So if you'd like to go see them, man, they're great singers. We really enjoy them as well. But so that's all we have there. But we're going to do some birthdays now. You wonder why I'm here, right? Amen. Because my wife's voice is not quite what she would like for it to be. So do we have any birthdays or anniversaries this morning? Anybody? Anybody have a birthday last week or whenever? Or maybe you had it 3 months ago and didn't get your pen? Anybody? Nobody? All right. We got the youngest church in town. Praise God. Nobody's getting older. Anybody been married longer that you'd like to? Amen. Anyway? All right. We're going to get into the service this morning. Amen. And just ask God to minister to the needs. Amen. Brother Marty, I hate to bother you again, but could you come up here and pray for us this morning? We got some special needs this morning, and we can't mention all of them, but we want you to pray for. Who do we want you to pray for? Keeley's uncle, amen, Bradley, he's in the ICU in Columbia. So he really needs your prayers this morning. So pray for him. Brother Sister Smith, Brother Sister Vaughn, Brother Chuck. There's just an awful lot of needs, and they are probably on the wall behind me. So in your time that you go to the Lord in prayer, would you pray for these?
Good morning. When I say he is risen, you repeat, he has risen indeed. Everybody got it? He has risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. All right. Lord Jesus, we just give you praise and thanksgiving for your sacrifice that you sacrificed for us, that men would be able to be redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ to everlasting life. To look forward to an eternity with God, our Father, who we can name. And we have been blessed with spiritual blessings, Lord. And we just want to wake up and see what our inheritance is and the glory that you have set before us. And Lord, to love you more deeply than we ever loved you before, that today would be a day when we could have just great rejoicing. And Lord God, whoever's in a position where they're through a trial or whatever they're going through, Lord, we just pray that your presence would be with them, that would encourage them, that would give them strength, let them know that they have been given a trial that they can withstand, and that the glory of God would be evident in their lives to be able to proclaim his truth. Give us a desire for your word. Pray for our children. We pray for our country, Lord. Pray for our leaders. And we just give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Brother Marty. Amen. Praise God. We got some songs this morning, and we got, I'm excited. I'm just excited about what God's going to do today. Brother John, are you ready to sing for us this morning?
I am Barabbas, a rebel, a prisoner. Death was a sentence for me. Led before Pilate, I stood there beside him. This man some were calling a king. And as the crowd shouted, crucify him, the soldiers let me go free. What kind of man, guilty of nothing, would suffer the shame and disgrace? Hang on a cross, despised and rejected, and willingly die in my place. At Calvary, someone like me. My name is Thomas. For 3 years I've followed. I saw every wonder and sign. They say he has risen, that his grave is empty, that just can't believe he's alive. Now standing before me, Jesus shows me the scars in his hands and his side. What kind of man embraces a doubter, lovingly drawing me near? I don't have to wonder if I've been accepted. He settled the worry and fear. At Calvary, for someone like me. Oh, how I failed him that night. I promised Jesus that I'd never leave him, and willingly lay down my life. But there at his trial, I stood by the fire. I denied him 3 times. What kind of man pours out his mercy? Someone who stumbles and falls, with no way to earn it, no way to deserve it. Forgiveness still came after all. At Calvary, for someone like me. I've been Barabbas, guilty set free. I have been Thomas, doubter redeemed. I have been Peter. Yes, I've been all three. What kind of man bleeds for the worthless and saves him whatever it takes? What kind of man would rescue a sinner and offer amazing grace? At Calvary, at Calvary, for someone like me, someone like me. Someone like me.
I can imagine that Barabbas probably was the most surprised man on that day when he came out, probably expecting to be led back to his jail cell and then crucified later, but somehow God set him free. There's a great message in that. I may be touching on that here in a little bit. I'm doing something now that not too many people know about. Jeremy, would you come over here, bud? Amen. Austin, would you put your guitar on the stand there and see, if I'd have told him beforehand, he'd have probably gone to the bathroom right about now, but I surprised. Amen. Where you at? You stand on the other side of me. This is me. This is my son. And this is my grandson. And he's got a son back there. That's four generations. This is not a four-generation thing, but the Bible says when you send somebody out to ministry that you should anoint them and to pray for them that they will go forth. Well, Austin's going to two types of ministry. He's leaving tomorrow to go back to Georgia, but then he'll be going to the Eastern Europe region, and it gets pretty close to Russia and Ukraine and all those. He'll be over there for 9 months, so he's going to be away from his family. But I've already talked to him about getting linked up at the chapel. When I went to Vietnam, it was one of the most spiritual times of my life. We had church. I helped start a church over there, and God moved and touched so many lives. And I want to pray the same thing for Austin, that his protection as well as being there, but also that God will use him and keep his hand on him. So I'm going to ask my son Jeremy if he will. No, I'm going to pray because you're going to pray here in just a moment. Amen. So we'll get this together. Lay your hands on your son there. Extend your hands this way, if you would, please. Father, God, glory to God. Glory, hallelujah. God, let the glory come down. Let your Holy Spirit rest upon Austin right now. Let the anointing of the Holy Ghost be upon him, Father, Lord, for protection. But God, for anointing, Father, that this tour of duty in this place, God, will be one that will draw him closer to you, Father. We pray that through his life, God, he'll be able to touch the lives of other soldiers, God, and to minister to them and to do great things in their lives, God. Lord, we're just believing you to do this, Father, as we send him forth. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for this opportunity, and we give you praise in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Yes. Praise God. And this will be one of the last times he'll get to sing for us, so we're going to let him do that right now.
This is a new song, Run to the Father. I'm sure you've heard it on the radio. Church I go to back home, Pastor Ryan always mentions. He's gone to seminary and all the stuff, been trained and went to school. But he says he's learned more about the grace of God and the love of the Father from being a husband and then also a father himself, understanding, or he doesn't have the context to understand it, which this song talks about in the second verse. Don't have the context to understand that kind of love. I don't understand and I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. So, hope you enjoy it.
Carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, oh. You You saw my condition and had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. I don't have the context for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again. I run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 oh. My heart has been in your sights long before my first breath, running into your arms is running to life from death. And I feel this rush deep in my chest, and I know your mercy just as I am. You pull me in, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father, fall into grace, done with my heart. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, again and again and again and again. Oh, oh,
I was thinking earlier as I was sitting up there and looking out here how I like to see the familiar faces come in and not be able to sit where they normally sit. Yeah. It's neat to see that, because you come in, my seat's gone. No, your seat's not gone. It's just somebody has filled that seat this morning. And so that is great. It is great to see everybody here in the house of God this morning on this Resurrection Sunday. It is a beautiful day. It is a day of new beginnings, new, vibrant, exciting things that God wants to do in your life, and you've come to the right place this morning. You've come into the house of God to hear what God wants to say to you this morning. And so thank you guys for showing up this morning. Thank you for viewing us online. We appreciate you for doing that on a weekly basis. And God has things great and exciting in store for this body of believers, for this church, for the different ministries that we are continuing on and starting up. And speaking on that note, a quick little side note, commercial break, whatever. The young adult ministry, we have our Sunday school class in the back on Sunday mornings. So show up for Sunday school, show up for the young adult ministry, however you want to look at it. But we're going to have a kickoff for our young adult ministry at our house on the 22nd. And I'll have more details next week. I don't want to get too much into it right now. So if you guys are interested in that, you can see me or see my wife. But next week, we'll talk more about that. It is good that we are here in the house of God on this beautiful day. And aren't you glad that we have a Father that we can run to that is, how do I put this? He's not only the surgeon that wants to take care of your problem, but he's also the friend that is going to be there with you throughout it all, okay? To love on you, to go to work and take care of the things that need to be taken care of, but there to wrap his arms around us and to love on us and just call us home. We have that type of Father for us, and He wants to share that with you this morning. We're getting ready to take up our tithes and our offerings. We've got the offering baskets here on the altars. We got one in the middle. You can mail it in or do it electronically via the Venmo app. So we appreciate you guys for doing that. And we're getting ready to go into worship. This is God's day, okay? You've come into the house of God on this Sunday to be with some family, I'm sure, but also to be in His house and to be in His presence. So as we get ready to sing these praise and worship songs, give Him your best. Give Him your utmost. But I don't sing the best. It doesn't matter. He just wants to hear from you. Amen? Amen. Heavenly Father, Lord, we love You. God, Lord, we thank You, Lord, for this day. God, Lord, we thank You for these freedoms that we have in this great country of ours, that we can serve You, we can worship You with no worries. God, we just pray, Lord, for Your hand to be upon this service this morning, Lord. Lord, be upon this tithes and this offerings, Lord, that we bring, Lord. We just ask You to receive them. God, receive our worship, Lord. And to Lord, we love You, and we glorify You, and we thank You. In Your name we pray. Amen.
Y'all would like to stand? Sorry.
I serve the risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see a hand of mercy, I hear a voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always here. He lives, He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You've asked me how I know He lives. He lives within my
rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up the voice and sing. Eternal hallelujah to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help to all who find. No other is so loving, so good. Walks with me and talks with me along my narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You've asked me how I know He lives. He lives within.
Say that chorus one more time.
He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along my narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You've asked me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out.
Praise God. Give him a big hand of praise, amen. You seated. Amen. Praise God. Good to be in the house of God on Resurrection Sunday. Amen. When the Lord rose from the dead. I tell you, Brother Fred, are you going to come over here? You're going to sing from there?
I'm going to stand right
here. All right. We'll see if he can contain to that one spot or not.
They tried my Lord and Master with no one to defend within the hall of power. Well, he stood without a friend. I'll be a friend to Jesus. My life on him I'll spend. I'll be a friend to Jesus until the the world may turn against him. His love to thee will end. And while on earth I'm living, our Lord shall
praise team a good hand this morning. They did an excellent job today. All of our singers and musicians. Amen. Got a little something special. We're having a play this morning with no actors. Is that okay? Amen. All right. See, Timmy on the back row says he wants to be a part. So if we crucify somebody after a while, Timmy, you're the man. All right. He'll get to hang on the cross. Amen. Let me borrow that mic, our music stand. Thank you, sir. Amen. Give them a moment to get everything in place. Saw some pretty good productions on the TV this morning, and if anybody saw Jensen Franklin, we won't quite measure up to that today. I apologize for that. But last week I talked about the last week in the life of Christ. And we started back at the time when he came into the city riding on a donkey. And we ended up with the Passover meal. I'll read you a scripture this morning out of Luke 24. beginning of verse 1. And very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. They found that a stone had been rolled away from the entrance, so they went in, but they didn't find the body of the Lord. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance, so that they went in and they did not find the body of the Lord, and they stood there puzzled. Two men suddenly appeared to them, clothed in dazzling robes. The women were terrified and bowed with their faces to the ground. And then the men asked, "Why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He has risen from the dead. Remember what he told you back in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and that he would rise again on the third day." Father, we just ask today, God, your very special anointing, Lord, for the benefit of these wonderful people. God, that there will be a message today that will be relayed that will touch their hearts and their minds and change them forever. Not one soul will leave here the way they came in, but everybody will be drawn closer to Christ. God, that's our reason for being here today. It's your reason for coming out of that grave and ascending to the Father. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Several events took place that week, and we ended up last week with communion. And the table would have looked something like this, and they, as they sat around, now I want you to go back in your mind, if you will, and just to view that, those disciples sitting around this table, they probably thought it was the highlight of their existence. They probably thought it won't get any better than this, and man, life is going to go good from here on out, because Jesus is going to be crowned king and we're going to be his right-hand men. And that's what they were thinking. As they were sitting around this table, of course, they had different conversation and everything. But there was one thing that Jesus said while they were here. He said, "One of you is going to betray me." And he looked over his shoulder, and Judas dipped his bread into the cup. And then Judas went out into the night. Jesus said, "Go do what you have to do." And the disciples didn't really understand what that meant. But Judas left, and he went out into the night to meet the high priest guards. As he was leaving, Jesus walking along, if you can picture this in your mind, Jesus is walking along with his disciples, and like I said, I've got a movie picture up here, and all of a sudden he just stops. And he said, "All of you, every one of you will betray me." Of course, you know, Peter couldn't stand for something like that being said. He said, "Oh no, Lord. I will never betray you. I will even go to the death for you." And all of the other disciples said, "Yeah, me too, Lord. Me too. We'll always be there for you anytime you need us. We'll never betray you." And Jesus looks at Peter and said, "Peter, before the sun rises in the morning, before the rooster will crow, you will have already denied me three times." They went out from Jerusalem across the Kidron Valley and come to the Mount of Olives, and there was an olive grove there, and we call there's a little garden. We call the Garden of Gethsemane. So Jesus led his disciples along with him, and you know, you can always depend on some people more than others. And so as the disciples get here, the others went on and they spread out a little bit, but he kept his main guys, you know, Peter and James and John, the inner circle, the ones that will always be there. And he said, "Hey guys," he said, "I need you to stay here with me at the entrance to the garden, and I want you to pray as I go inside and pray, because I got something really heavy on my heart today, and I need your prayers." Anybody ever told you that they needed your prayers? And, "Oh, yes, I will." And we see that the disciples, as they knelt there and began to pray, Jesus came in, and I may have found a rock or whatever, and he kneels beside this rock, and he begins to pray, and his heart is very, very heavy. Tears begin to stream down his cheeks, and he begins to sweat. He said his sweat became as great drops of blood. He prayed a prayer that I never would have thought I'd ever heard Jesus pray. He said, "Oh, Father, if there's any way, let this cup pass from me." You see, Jesus could look ahead in time, and he knew exactly what was going to happen. He knew the pain and the torture that he was going to be going through with. And so his cry was, "Oh God, if there's any way," he prays, and then he gets up and he comes back to the entrance of the garden, and he founds his three most trusted disciples asleep. He said, "You couldn't even stay awake for an hour. You couldn't even pray with me 1 hour." And so they wake up, and he goes back to pray again, and he does this 3 times. And each time that he does it, the disciples fall asleep. That kind of says something for mankind, doesn't it? You know, it kind of says something for each of us. How many of you have fallen asleep on Jesus? How many of us have fallen asleep on our relationship with God? God says, "I'll die for you if you'll just live for me." And we say, "Okay, Lord," and they fall asleep. And the commitments we make to him over the years, they just kind of seem to weather out, and we kind of forget about them. But Jesus came back, and the 3rd time, he said, "Sleep on, forget it, don't worry about it." But about that time, there was an angry mob. He could hear them yelling in the distance. First he heard the sound of the guards and the yelling and the chattering, and then he began to see the torches, and they began to see the dust kicking up from the throat, and then they come down the street, the road, the dirty road, and they come pretty close to Jesus, and there's one of them, a man in that crowd, that steps out. If you remember Judas, he left the table. Judas steps out of this crowd of angry people, and he walks right up to Jesus, and he said, "Master," hugs him, gives him a kiss on the cheek, and then steps back into the crowd. Then the other guards, they step forth to arrest him, because the sign had already been given. Judas had told him, said, "Now, the one that I kiss and call master, he's the one that you need to arrest." And we would have figured that Jesus had been all over and people had seen him, so surely they knew what he looked like. But maybe the darkness of the night, and just to absolutely make sure, he conceived this plan so there would be no problem. And they reached out and they grabbed Jesus. And you got the disciples, you got Peter, James, and John standing very closely. So Peter's still on fire. He's still ready to stand up for Jesus. And he pulls his sword out of his sheath, and he hits the guard on the side of the head, and the guard's ear falls to the ground. Now Jesus, being Jesus, Jesus not having any animosity, Jesus not hating people, but Jesus wanting to touch the heart of every man at the very moment he was being arrested to be taken off, wants to show one more act of love. Now he could have left that ear laying on the ground. That blood could have poured out of the side of that man's head, and he could have been dead in a few moments. You see, Jesus cares for you even at the last moment, when there may not be another moment. And he reaches down and he picks that ear up and he puts it on the high side of Malchus's head, and it was instantly healed. The guards then take Jesus from that point and they lead him to the house of Caiaphas. Caiaphas was the high priest. He was the one that had devised this plan and tried to, "We've got to figure out a way that we can find something against him." I mean, there wasn't anything they'd find against Jesus. All Jesus had done his entire life was minister to people, heal, deliver, loose, set free, be kind, and be there for everybody. But they've got to find something to be able to find this man deserving of death. Well, they had plenty of people come as witnesses. I mean, they were just pouring. There were people just, you know, there's always people that hate God. Do you know that? Now, we're sitting here this morning, we can't imagine that, but evidently there was a lot of people that day, because they said the witnesses just kept coming and coming. And every one of them had a story to tell. They didn't hold water. One man comes, "Hey, I heard him say that he would tear the temple down, and in 3 days he would lift it back up. He would rebuild it." Of course, Jesus wasn't talking about the temple in Jerusalem. He was talking about his body. How that his body would be torn down, but in 3 days he would come back. And so Caiaphas is sitting there looking at him, and he finally got fed up with the whole situation. "Tell me, are you the Son of God? Are you the Christ?" Jesus kind of said, "You said it. You said it. From now on, you will see me sitting at the right hand of the Father, coming on the clouds of glory." Boy, I tell you, that made Caiaphas so mad he could spit nails. What more do we need? This man has blasphemed. He has created blasphemy. And so they said, take him to Pilate. We'll have him crucified. We'll have him convicted on this cross. So they lead him into the courtyard there at Pilate's judgment hall. And this is early in the morning. We're talking about something over here at the Last Supper that took place on Thursday evening. This is going, you've heard of an all-nighter? This was an all-nighter. All night long, they had conceived this plan. They had arrested him. They had brought him to Caiaphas' house. They had had the little courts there, their kangaroo trials, if you will. And now, early in the morning, they bring him to the house of Pilate, into Pilate's judgment hall. And Jesus is standing there, and there's a few people around. There's the guards, and we see that as Pilate is being woken up, maybe perhaps, and coming out on the praetorium and getting ready to see what's going on, we see that there's something going on. There's a commotion. They'd built a fire. It was evidently pretty cool. And they'd built a fire, and the guards were standing around it. And there was also another man standing around the fire warming his hands, and it was Peter. Now, we got to give Peter some credit. I mean, most of the disciples had already dispersed, and Peter said, I'll never leave you. I'll always be there. And how many of us have said that? And Peter's standing there just, what's going to happen? What is going to happen? So as Peter's standing there, one young girl come up to him and said, I know you. I saw you with Jesus the other day. No, you got the wrong person. That wasn't me. Then a little bit later, another one came up to him and said, I'm sure that I saw you with him. No, that was not me. And then finally a man came up to him and said, your speech, you're a Galilean. You're one of his. I know that you were with Jesus. And this time Peter becomes very violent and very angry. And he said, I told you I don't know the man. Leave me alone. And so about that time, off in the distance, we hear a rooster crow. Then Peter began to remember just a few hours before Jesus said, before the rooster ever crows in the morning, Peter, you will already have denied me three times. Peter's, you can imagine, my God, what have I done? My God, what have I done? I betrayed the best friend that I've ever known. His head hangs low. And Jesus kind of glances down at him, and his eyes connect with the eyes of Peter. Jesus doesn't hate Peter. Jesus has some sympathy for Peter. He realizes under the pressure. You see, Peter made those statements in his own flesh. I will never deny you. I will always be there for you. When everybody else does, I'll always be there. But you know what? We can't walk this road by ourselves. We can't walk this road on our own ability. We need Him. And I think even Peter realized that night, oh my God. My God, I thought in my strength I could have pulled it, but I can't. My Lord, have mercy upon me. And he bowed his head. As they bring Jesus in, and they begin to ask him, and Pilate says, why have you brought, what's going on here? Why have you brought this man to me so early in the morning? And the high priest said, we want him crucified. He has claimed to be the Son of God, which is a king, and there's only one king, and he's claiming to be the king. He is worthy of death. But you see, Pilate had a message from his wife. You know, God speaks to all kinds of people, and God spoke to Pilate's wife the night before in a dream, and she said, you tell Pilate not to have anything to do with this. This is a just man, a good man. And so Pilate, not knowing really what to do, because when you got an angry mob, anything could happen. So Pilate says, I don't see anything wrong with him. But by the way, Herod is in town, and I'm going to send him to Herod, King Herod. So he sends Jesus to King Herod. Herod, they bring him before Herod, and Herod also examines him, and he can't find a thing wrong with Jesus. All he can see, let me tell you something here. You see, maybe you don't have to see it or feel it or understand it with human language. But when you stand in the presence of an almighty God, no words have to be spoken. And I can just somehow kind of believe that when he stood, Herod there facing the Son of God, something began to penetrate his heart and his mind. Herod also realized there's nothing wrong with this man. Not my problem anyway. I'm sending him back to Pilate. So he sends him back to Pilate, and there again in that judgment hall, Pilate had the highest hopes that Herod would take care of the problem. Pilate didn't want anything to do with this. So he begins to say, this man hasn't done anything wrong. I'll have him beaten and we'll release him. No, that's not good enough. And Pilate has a plan. He remembers that it's the custom of the Jews that each year they would release a prisoner. And so he thinks, you know, what can I do here? And he remembers that if it was today, we'd remember on the 6 o'clock news just a month or two ago, they finally arrested the most notorious criminal in all of the land. This guy was a murderer, a thief, an insurrectionist, every evil, wicked thing that you can think of about somebody. This man had done it. Pilate says, I'll get him. I'll get this man. His name is Barabbas. John sang about him a while ago. I'll bring this Barabbas out, and they'll have to let Jesus go. So they bring Barabbas out, stands him here, and bring Jesus over, and they stand him beside him. And Pilate said, it's your custom, not mine, yours, that every year we release to you a prisoner. You all are familiar with Barabbas. The terrible things that he had done, the many times that you begged the authorities, please find this man, please arrest him, please take him out of society, lock him up to where he'll never be. You remember that. He's an ungodly individual. So today I'm going to ask you, and it's your choice. You know, you're going to make the choice. And isn't that the way life goes? Nobody can make choices for you. You can choose today whether you're going to accept Barabbas, or you can choose today whether you're going to accept Christ. No, preacher, no. It's not like that. I would never accept Barabbas. You know, but you haven't accepted Christ, maybe somebody. And when you haven't accepted Christ, you have accepted Barabbas. As a wise old preacher from Mississippi says, he said that you either is or you ain't a sinner or a saint. There's no in-between, friend. I mean, you're either on God's side or you're on Satan's side. So Pilate knows that he's got this plan that no way could it fail. So tell me now, who do you want released? Unbelievably, he heard out of the crowd, the voices began, give us Barabbas. What? Now, you misunderstood the way I said that. Who do you want released today to come back into society, to live amongst you, to be there, to be your next door neighbor, to terrorize your neighborhood? Which one is it you want? And my goodness, and you know what they said, give us Barabbas. Give us Barabbas. Pilate knows that this mob, their preconceived ideas, there's nothing he can do to change this. So he beckons to the guard. And the guard unshackles Barabbas, and Barabbas walks down those steps. I can see Barabbas in my mind as he walks down a little ways, and he stops, and he looks back at Jesus. Barabbas, I can believe in his heart. Barabbas said, I don't understand what just happened here. I don't understand this. I've heard about that guy. Man, he's done nothing but good, and I'm a total, complete minister society, and I'm going free, and he's staying there. Did you get the message in that? In all of our sins, we should be punished. In the life we've lived, the things we've done, the times we've denied Christ, we should hang on that cross. But we walk free, just like Barabbas did. As Barabbas makes his way down, Pilate then looks out at the crowd. All right, you've got him. What do you want me to do with Christ? What would you have me to do with this man, Jesus? And they said, crucify him. Crucify him. Crucify him. Pilate couldn't believe the anger, the prejudice, how ridiculous this was. Crucify him. Pilate realizes there's nothing more he can do. He realized that he must release Jesus into their hands. So they take Jesus and he hands him to the Jews. He says, you take and do with Jesus whatever you decide to do. I'll have him beaten. I'll have him scourged. I'll have him punished. But beyond that, it's your call. And so they release Jesus into their hands. But I want to tell you something. He walks over to a basin of water, pours the water into the basin, and he washes his hands. I wash my hands of this unjust, filthy crime. It's not going to be on my hands. His blood will be upon you, upon your hands, and upon your children's hands. And they take Jesus and they lead him away. Then we see the next scene that they've taken Jesus and they've placed a big, large wooden beam across his shoulders. I'm sure you can picture a railroad tie. I don't think it probably was that big, but similar to that, which weighed quite a bit. And a strong man could have carried that beam and there wouldn't have been any problem. You know, some healthy young whippersnapper could have picked that beam up, put it on my shoulders, and walked all the way up the hill. But we're not talking about some strong young man. We're talking about somebody that had literally been beaten to within an inch of his life. There was not much breath in him. There was not much strength left in him. He was literally brutalized beyond recognition. The Bible says that his face was almost unrecognizable as a human being. And they take this beam and they strap it to his arms, however they did it. And then they begin to lead him down a road towards Calvary's Hill. A dusty road, a dirty road, a road they call the Way of Suffering, a road that we've also heard called the Via Dolorosa. And they lead him down that cross, and I can picture in my mind just every few feet the weight of that cross, he would fall to the ground, and some guard would get up, and he'd pick him back up. He'd walk a little bit further, and he'd stumble again, all the way up this road to this place called Calvary. Finally, he stumbles and he can't get back up. And they look in the crowd and there was a man. They didn't know who he was. Even though God had ordained this from a long, long time ago, they reach out and they grab this man. His name was Simon. He'd just come in from the countryside, from the city of the country of Cyrene. And they said, carry his cross. When a Roman guard tells you to do something, you do it. And so he picks that beam up and he goes ahead of Jesus, carrying that cross, Jesus trotting along behind him, limping and barely making it. And they finally climb to the top of that hill just outside Jerusalem. It's called Calvary. It's called Golgotha. One description of it said it's a place of the skull. I've seen pictures. I don't know if this is accurate or not, but the rough, rocky terrain of that hillside looked almost like a skull. This was the place to where they took criminals. This was a common place to where criminals were crucified and put to death. And after that, they'd take them out and they'd throw them on the city dump and burn them. That's what they did with criminals. And so they led this up and they get to the top of the hill and they lay the beam down. They lay Jesus down on top of the beam. And the next thing you hear is they tie him to that cross. Those large hammers and those big metal spikes. Clink! Clank! Clank! And in between each clank was a, oh! 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 The pain that must have been so unbearable as Jesus lay there. They nailed his hands to that beam. They nailed his feet to the other beam. And then they hoisted that cross into the air and it fell down in a hole. And there Jesus Christ the Son of God is hanging, stretched out between earth and heaven, just hanging there. As he looks out at the crowd, sees the people. There were different types of people in the crowd, just as there are different types of people in the world. There were some of the people in the crowd that day that were weeping. They were weeping bitter tears because this was Jesus. Maybe the woman whose son had been raised from the dead that come out of the city, maybe she was there that day. Maybe one of the lepers that had been cleansed from his leprosy, maybe he was there. And maybe some of the guys that had blind eyes, but now they could see, maybe they were there. We don't know. There was a lot of people there. This was a pretty big event. And then there were the people that wanted him dead. And that's the world you live in today. Did you know that? That's the world we live in today. There's a people today in the world that love Jesus and would do anything for Jesus. And there's people that could care less about Jesus and care less about the church. And we'll see here in just a moment of two of those people. And as he looks out at the crowd, he looks at them, and at one point he says this, and I'm saying it right here for a reason. In a weak, strained voice, "Father, forgive them." Can I add to it just a little bit? That Roman soldier had drove that spike in my hand. He didn't know what he was doing. That guy over there that spit upon me, he didn't know what he was doing. And the one that took that sponge and dipped it in the bitter gall and placed it in my, he didn't know what he was doing. Father, would you forgive them? He picked out the most ungodly amongst them. And he said, "Father, those are the ones I want you to forgive. Those are the ones I want you to give another opportunity and another chance." Can anybody here say, thank God he did? Amen. I wasn't the most upstanding young 18-year-old kid when for some reason out of the blue, God one Wednesday night decided to save me and change my life. Thank God he did. Thank God he did. About that time, there was two thieves behind him. One on the right, one on the left. And just as the crowd, there was the one on the left. I'm sure he didn't care for Jesus. He said, "If you're who you say you are," don't you love the sarcasm? "If you big mighty God, if you're who you say you are, why don't you just get down off that cross, take us with you, and let's all walk free if you're who you say you are." The other thief, you see, the other thief, something happened to him. I want to take you back to a time when Peter, when Jesus was sitting around the coast of Caesarea Philippi with his disciples one night, and he asked them, "Who do men say that I am?" Oh, they gave a description of Jeremiah, John the Baptist, one of the prophets. But then he asked the question, "But who do you? Who do you? Who do you say that I am?" And Peter said, "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then Jesus replied with this, "Flesh and blood has not revealed that unto you, but my Father which is in heaven." And on the cross that day, I don't know what it was, but this man over here was acting in the flesh, that one. He was expressing his anger of an ungodly attitude. But this one over here said something that in his own he could not have known. Flesh and blood didn't reveal it. But God had spoken to that man's heart. Because he looked at Jesus and said, "Jesus, when you go to your kingdom, would you remember me?" Very, very simple prayer, not eloquent at all. He hadn't been to any kind of classes to learn how to become a Christian. But out of his heart, he prayed the most simple prayer that he could have prayed. When you go to your kingdom, would you just remember me? Just remember me. Please, please just remember me. Flesh and blood didn't reveal that to him. God spoke to that thief's heart. And God would have spoken to the other thief's heart too, if he would have allowed him to. And when you came to Christ, it wasn't any big, eloquent thing that somebody had spoken to you, but the Spirit of God spoke to your heart. Spirit of God drew you into a place you had never been before, and you realize, you know what? I need God. All of these other things that I've lived my life for and I thought that I needed, I don't really need those things. I thought I needed a bigger job, better job and a bigger house and more cars and nicer clothes. I thought I needed, but you know, when it comes right down to the cross, when it comes right down to the time that you've only got moments and hours at the best to live, you could care less about those things. And that's if you'll let God speak to you, He'll give you an opportunity to say a prayer. My prayer the night I got saved was not eloquent. It didn't repeat after anybody. It was, my God, I don't want to die and go to hell. That was it. My God, I don't want to die and go to hell. I'm an 18-year-old boy. I don't want to die and go to hell. And that thief on the cross, all he could think, oh, Lord, would you please remember me? And if you'll cry that prayer to Jesus, Lord, would you remember me? I don't want to die and go to hell. Yeah, we can lead you through a very fancy, eloquent prayer, and those are good. They're fine. There's nothing wrong with them. But when you're knocking at death's door, you may not have a chance to repeat all the words. But the words that come out of your heart are the words that's going to touch the heart of God. Can I say that again? The words that will come out of your heart are the words that are going to touch the heart of God. And that day, that simple prayer touched Jesus. And Jesus glanced over his left shoulder and said, today, not tomorrow. Today's our last day. This is it. But today, you'll be with me in paradise. Praise God. It's getting close to the Passover. Getting close to the time of thieves. They can't have crucifixions on the Sabbath. And so the guards come up to take the thieves off the cross, but they must be dead. They must be dead before they can take them off the cross. So they come in with large pieces of metal or whatever it might have been, and they come up to the first thief and they break his legs, because when you break their legs, they suffocate. Because on the cross, you can actually live if you can stand and get one more breath. But when your legs are broken, you can't do that. Just in a short period of time, you die of suffocation. To the one thief and then to the another thief, and they hang there and they're dead. But then there's something else that happened on the cross. Jesus, as he looked out at lost humanity, there's a lot more said. I'm not going to say it all today. But Jesus, as he looked out at everybody, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. There was something else that happened. All of a sudden, the sky became black. At noon, till 3 o'clock, the sky became so black you would have thought it was night. And an earthquake began to take place, and the thunder began to roll, and the lightning began to flash. And Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Father, why have you left me at this time? And Jesus hung there, and he said, it is finished. And he died. You see, he did that at that darkest hour in history. Why he did that was because when God, his Father, had to turn his head away from him, was when he took your sins and yours and yours and yours and yours and mine. He took those sins upon himself and he bore them for us. In other words, let me say it like this. He paid the price that I could not pay. He paid the price that I could live and not have to die. And he did it. And that's when God the Father shut everything down, turned the sky black. And Jesus said, why have you forsaken me? And if he would have replied, it would have been like this. Because Jesus, you've got to bear the sins alone. What sins are we talking about? We're talking about from Adam's sin throughout time, to the closing man that will ever live on face of the earth. And everybody's sin that's in this room this morning, on that day, Jesus took your sin so that you could be forgiven. And he died. So when the guards come up to break his legs, they saw that he was already dead. But just to make sure, one of them took a spear and he lunged it into the side of Jesus. And Jesus didn't even flinch. Not a flicker. He was already dead. So there was no reason to break his legs. And there they stand just a few short time before the Sabbath would come, taking the thieves off the cross to take them to the burn pile. A couple of men come walking up here, and one's name was Joseph from the city of Arimathea, and the other was Nicodemus that we read about in the third chapter of John. They were both of the Sanhedrin. They were both high religious figures. They were a part of the church, if I may. But yet at the same time, they were not only a part of the church out there that hadn't accepted Christ, but they had accepted Christ. But they decided just to keep it quiet for a while. But here's where the clincher comes in. There comes a time in everybody's life that you can't deny Christ any longer. There comes a time that even though they had been quiet, I'm not saying they were bad, but they had kept it quiet enough. But now they said, you know what, we're stepping out. We're stepping up today. It doesn't matter if somebody takes us. Their love for Christ was so deep that if this cost them their life, so be it. But he had went to Pilate, he had got the papers of authority, and he came to the guard, and he said, I have papers here that give me the authority to take the body of Jesus and bury him. The guard examines the papers, hands them back to him, and says, take him. They take the body of Jesus, and they carry him out to a place to where Joseph had his own personal tomb, and he wasn't going to use it. He was going to give that tomb to Jesus. And they lay Jesus inside to where this big stone is. They lay him on a cold stone slab. And there in that cold stone slab, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, lays totally, completely dead. And they roll the stone back in place. They place the guards in front of it to make sure that he wouldn't be able to escape. And there he lays. Now, the Bible doesn't say this, but there's plenty of information to back it up. But can I just imagine? Can I just imagine that the moment they rolled that stone in front of that tomb, Jesus did this. And he got up. And he just stood up. And he took, because the Bible says that the napkin on his head was folded and laid there. So he took this napkin off and he folded it nice and neat and he lay it there. And then he left. And that sounds good. But what next? We got a tomb with stone rolled in front of it. Early the next morning, Sunday, which would be Easter Sunday. That's today. Two women, Mary Magdalene, I heard preacher talking about Mary Magdalene this morning. She was the one that they cast seven devils out of. So evidently, before she came to Christ, evidently before she surrendered to God, she was a very ungodly lady. I'm not going to describe all that she might have been involved in, but she came because, you see, when Jesus changed her life, she had made a sold-out commitment to Christ. And when he changed her life, her and another Mary came, and they came, and along the way they said, we've come to anoint the body, but how are we going to roll that stone away? So they get there, and they find out the stone had already been rolled away. And there was a man, well, Matthew, I like the way Matthew said it, there was an angel. The Bible says this, that God sent an angel to roll the stone away. And so as they get near the place, there's this angel standing there, and he asks him, he said, I know why you've come. You've come to see Jesus who was crucified. Then you know what he said? He's not here. He's risen. Why do you seek the living amongst the dead? He's alive. He's alive. He's alive forevermore. And we've got a video we want to show you here in just a moment. But before I get to that point, I want to just point out something. Christ didn't die on the cross so we could do a little semi-play here this morning. But he died on the cross for this purpose, so that nobody, absolutely nobody. God does not want anybody to die and go to hell. But he wants every person to accept his son and go to heaven. And he paid a price. There had to be blood shed. And there was blood shed on that cross that day. Blood shed for the forgiveness of sins. In the Old Testament, they used to sacrifice animals, and that was a temporary fix. But Jesus was not a temporary fix. He was the fix that took even before his time to the end of time. He was the sacrifice from the foundation of the world. And so, as they come there, and they find out that tomb is empty, and he is risen from the dead. I forgot to tell you the title of my sermon, didn't I? Well, my goodness, maybe, can I give it to you now at the end? The title of this sermon was, "The Sun is Coming Up in the Morning." Hit the lights and play this video. Bear with us, we're having more technical problems.
Go ahead. You see.
that. Amen. Here's a scripture that I'm going to say probably just about everybody knows it. It's called John 3:16. For God so loved the world, that's us, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That's what this whole thing was. The Passion Week of Christ was so that man's salvation could be sealed. God loves you, my friend. God wants every person in this room to go to heaven. He does not want to. I don't care what you did. And God doesn't care what you did. He just wants you to come to his Son. So all of this room this morning, I'm going to pray a prayer. You can pray with me if you'd like. You can even say, Lord, I don't want to die and go to hell. Lord, remember me when you come to your kingdom. But I'm going to pray this prayer, and if you feel something tugging upon your heart, and you feel like today is the day you want to change your life, today is the day you want to step out and become a child of God. If you're not, many of you already are. But if you're here and by chance you're not, my friend, I love you. I love you. But God's love for you outshines anything I could ever define as love. He died for you. Took your place, took my place on that cross. He died for us. All we have to do is say, Lord, forgive us. I want to serve you. So let's pray together. You pray in your hearts. You pray out loud, however you would like to pray. Father, as we come to you today, we come with the utmost praise and thanksgiving, God, for what you've done for each and every one of us. Lord, we thank you, God, for what we've seen this morning. Not that we like it or enjoy it, God, but it was something that had to take place for Scripture to be fulfilled. And Lord, as we come to you today, we just pray a very simple prayer. Lord, forgive me of all of my sins. Come into my heart and into my life and change me today. Set me up on a new path, a new direction, a new life. God, from this moment on, my intention, my plans, and with your help, I will serve you, God. I'll walk as a new creation. I'll be your child if you will accept me. And I believe you will. And I thank you for this. I ask it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. 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 We thank you all for coming today. And more than one miracle has taken place. It's exactly 12 o'clock noon right now. How about that? My goodness, God is good. Amen. Brother Terry Green, would you stand and dismiss us in prayer this morning?